That's the only way I know. Don't stop till everything's gone. Don't back down. Full throttle, wide open. You get tired, you don't show it. Dig a little deeper when you think you can't dig no more. That's the only way I know.
Saturday at the world's fastest speedway, is old friendships cemented? While it's like the first day of school, others are looking for new best friends. Because to qualify on the pole at Talladega, it's something you're not going to be able to do by yourself. What will be the right pairing, the right draft, to get you in the right spot for Sunday's Aaron's 499, welcome to qualifying at the world's fastest speedway. It is a gorgeous day. Temperature in the low 70s, a light breeze, and full sun. As we get set for the most anticipated qualifying session maybe ever in NASCAR history, and I'm not kidding, because for the first time at a track where the engines are restricted and the cars run in big packs, we have knockout qualifying. Everybody has a plan, Darrell. But
yeah, you know what I love about this? Normally you come to Talladega and drivers says, hey, my job's easy. I just get in the car, hold it wide open, I steer it around the track. Guess what? That isn't the way it is going to, it's not the way it's going to be today. It's all up to the driver, really. The driver and the crew chief. The crew chief has this strategy. The driver and the spotter, they got to execute the strategy. So it's in the driver's hands today as to where he ends up in qualifying.
Well, one driver, Dale Earnhardt Jr., said he expects this session to look a bit like drunken karaoke. Everybody knows what they want to try to do. Is it going to come out that way?
Now, Mike, I think whether you're a single car team or part of a multi-car operation, you came here with a strategy and a plan. And I think after those 2 1-hour practices yesterday, everyone figured out that's not going to work. I think the conclusion is the way your driver can maybe sit on his pole is he has to time it to be with the right group, possibly catching another group. It's not going to be about a plan or about a strategy.
Our point standing leader in the Sprint Cup Series has a real good feel for what it takes to be out front at Talladega. Let's meet him with Matt Yoakum.
One of the more interesting storylines Friday in practice was the Hendrick House cars and the Alliance cars all teaming up with a few stragglers at the end. So is that going to be the same game plan today to try to hook up with your corporate teammates as well as the in-house cars?
You know, we tried it. I'm not so sure that it worked. So it seems like everybody's abandoned that. So I don't know if we even know. We drew 41, so we're back here. I think a lot of us changed after looking at what happened in nationwide qualifying last night. So you want to be as far behind the big pack as possible, but getting enough of a toe off of a few cars ahead of you to just keep, gaining that momentum. And I don't know if anyone really knows exactly how to pull that off. Some of it's going to be strategy. Some of it's going to be luck. And, I've got Tony here, Denny, few other good cars back here, so hopefully we can make that happen. But I remember when coming to Talladega was pretty much the easiest day I had all year long for qualifying, and then it ramped up for the race. I think that's all changed now.
A prolific plate racer, and the guys right behind us, they're putting one last coat of wax on this 24 car.
Well, Carl Edwards, I read that you said this weekend if you weren't actually in this session, you would be doing what?
Oh, I'd be tuned in because let me tell you, if I get knocked out of it, I'm going to be watching. I mean, this is going to be, even practice yesterday got crazy. People were, trying all sorts of games and everything. So I think there's a lot of strategy right now. Jimmy Finnegan and I sat there at the back of the car and came up with about 3 different ideas just in the last few minutes. So nobody really knows what's going to happen here.
So you sort of have a game plan, but it's a loose one.
Yeah. Well, what is it? If you not making a choice is a choice. And right now we've made the choice to not have a plan. So, that's our honest plan. We don't have a plan. Now, we might come up with a plan in the first 30 or 40 seconds once cars get on the racetrack. But right now, I have no instructions. We're just going to try to do our best to stick with some Fords, hopefully get some fast laps, get into the next round. And I mean, if we can put our fast and all Ford on the pole, that'd be great.
Thanks, man.
All right, thanks.
Maybe sometimes the best plan is no plan at all. Dale Earnhardt Jr., among those trying to win his first Talladega pole, will explain the format after this. The season began with the Daytona 500, and knockout qualifying was not part of the program. Single car runs, as was traditional for the sport's biggest race at Daytona. So now we come to the other high-speed track of NASCAR, where the engines are restricted, and knockout qualifying, 24 returns to Fox, if you haven't noticed. 24 cars advance in round number one. We will set positions 25 to 43 for Sunday's race, and we'll know who goes home in round one. 24 cars on track for round two. Half of them advance to the final round. The remainder earn positions 13 to 24 on the starting grid. Then round three, and the fastest lap wins the pole. And starting positions 1 through 12 are set. So three rounds of knockout qualifying for you today on Fox. Join Chris Devoto.
So it's all about having a plan, but with Martin Truex, I want to know, at what point does that plan go right out your window?
Probably as soon as everybody lines up where you don't want them to. So it's it sounds like a lot of the teams have plans to go out together, and that's all fine and well till we leave pit road and we're out in the spots we want to be. So it's going to be interesting, to say the least. I think everybody's kind of learning as they go at this point. Obviously everybody's goal is to get the pole, but I think for us it's important, because it's not important where you start. We really want to race this car on Sunday, so I'm going to try to keep it safe.
You had a fast car in Daytona, a fast car in practice here at Talladega.
One of the fastest cars back at Daytona in the 500 was Denny Hamlin in the 11. They brought that piece here. This is knockout qualifying, a lot of different game plans up and down the grid. Are you going to stick with the Toyotas, or do you have a different plan out on the racetrack?
I think we have an organized group, but, you know, who knows what goes on with that organized plan. It's you try to do the best you can. I think our main objective is to get the 66 in the field, and then once we do that, then we'll see what happens in the next round. But hopefully, we got to get to those next rounds. I think really, it's an advantage really for these single car teams to not be associated to anyone, because they get to latch on to other groups. So it's kind of a sit and wait game, see how it all plays out.
Certainly going to be the e-ticket ride today.
The 66 he mentioned is Michael Waltrip, who is Fox's own and running a limited schedule in the Sprint Cup Series this year. Daytona, Talladega, maybe a couple of other races. Most of us drove to the track this morning on Interstate 20 at 70 miles per hour. At the world's fastest speedway, they run a little quicker. The yellow line is 70 miles an hour. And at highway speed, you can just about get from the start-finish line, which is here, out of turn two, by the time a race car completes a full lap of 2.66 miles.
Yeah, I know some people probably say, why are you starting down in turn one? Because that's where the start-finish line is here.
Everybody's ready for knockout qualifying for the Aaron's 499 on Fox. Sports Go to find your channel. Go to foxsports1.com today. Now, you see how the cars are lined up along pit road. That's Michael Annett's number 7, closest to the pit exit. This order was determined by random draw prior to qualifying. So teammates are not lined up with teammates. People driving the same make of car will have to find each other. And you're about to learn who is your new best friend.
Yeah, you know, it's going to be interesting how these plans that these guys have laid out. Look at this. We need a traffic cop down there right now. People ask me every week, why do they back out of their pit stalls? And I quite honestly can't answer that.
25-minute session. You see the clock in the upper right. Miss Coors Light waved the green flag, indicating the start of this 25-minute first round.
I think based on the two practices yesterday, most of these drivers know that quick lap comes at the beginning of the session when you have a lot of drivers out on the racetrack.
As expected.
Yeah, here goes the Ford guys.
And that's no surprise that the two Penske Fords of Keselowski and Logano take off, and there's a Ford driver in Aqua. That's Ricky Stenhouse Jr.
I think what you're going to see here, Mike, is that's a bunch of Ford cars up there. You're going to see a bunch of Chevrolet cars come out here. Then you're going to see some Toyota cars come out. I think they're coming out in groups.
But look who's jumped in the middle of the Penske cars, the 95 of Michael McDowell. That's significant because that single car team that the Phoenix native drives for has to make the race on speed. So he has to get out there with a quick pack. He's done it.
He's got a good working relationship with the Penske teams, though. That's almost like one of their cars.
They are up to speed quickly around the outside groove of this super speedway on a wind-up lap. They'll be near 200 when they come to the front straightaway. And look at all the jostling of, I don't want to be first, I want to be in the back of the school bus among that crowd.
Yeah, you want to get a big pack ahead of you and then chase them down. That's what you want to be able to do.
So Keselowski leads this fast freight as on the other side of the speedway. Everybody's still jostling for position.
Mike,
now, there are still more than a dozen cars on pit road that have not gone on the track yet.
What these guys here could be doing, I'm not sure what they're thinking right now, but they could be waiting for Keselowski and this group to come up, to come by and catch up to the tail end of them and start using those guys to graft off of.
Watch the two petty cars trying to catch that lead group of four. Probably in the best seat right now, Marcus Ambrose in that dark yellow number 9, because he is catching that front pack.
But what these drivers that are just now getting up to speed, they're trying to time it where they can get assembled and run that pack down. I think that's where the quick lap is going to be.
Almirola and Ambrose go to the top of the chart. That's the dark yellow and blue car, the tandem that is getting the benefit of the draft from those front four cars.
And the closing rate is unbelievable when you're catching another pack.
But that's really what it's going to take. You got to have a pack of cars in front of you, and then you got to chase them down. Doesn't matter if you're in the middle of the pack or at the back. You follow the back, you get a good pull up to the other cars, get a fast speed.
Pylon on the right of the screen gives the current position of the top drivers. Remember, 24 will advance to round two.
Yeah, you know, normally, Mike, when you say somebody's sucking up, that's not a compliment. But today, that's what you got to be able to do. Now, here are the Toyota guys. They're trying to group up here into a group.
Now, you see Kyle Busch in the M&M 18 car. He is only out there trying to learn and maybe to help a teammate. He will have to start the race tomorrow at the rear of the field because they changed engines last night.
Marcus Ambrose quickest as they continue to gain on that lead pack. Here are the four Stewart Haas cars all lined up together. It's a little like Noah's Ark at 200 miles an hour here. That's Kurt Busch, Danica Patrick, Tony Stewart, and Kevin Harvick.
Yeah, yesterday in practice we had five cars that ran over 200 miles an hour. We don't have a organized group right now. We're at 195. We'll get to 200 when they get organized, I believe.
This is the group you better watch right now. Look at Matt Kenseth in the 20. Look how they're just mowing by that pack on the inside that just left pit road. I think this is the group to really watch right now.
But that
now.
Pack on the inside, Larry, is giving them what they want. They want that little bit of draft. It's not much, but it helps. 198.
Marcus Ambrose still fastest now. Reed Sorensen in the 36. From the Tommy Baldwin two-car team is fastest, along with Cole Witt and Alex Bowman, two rookies, second and third.
See, this is the cool thing about this. Those guys, they don't have any teammates. They don't have to worry about making somebody mad or working with somebody. They're just trying to get a fast lap. Witt, Bowman, those guys are up there on their own.
From Dale Earnhardt Jr., looking back at Michael Waltrip.
Michael's pretty good at timing it, man, I'm telling you. Yesterday he had the fifth quickest time. Today, I guarantee he'll fall back there. He'll get him a nice run, and he'll have a fast speed.
The first group coming to pit road, as David Ragan leads a bunch, and now Jeff Gordon in front of the four Stewart Haas cars. And you notice Tony Stewart trying to move up into the top 24.
Johnson to the top.
Stewart's jumped to 20th. Jimmy Johnson to the top. You saw the 9. All those cars on the outside are fading. They're probably headed for pit road.
I think you can sit here and run a long time. They don't have them. They don't have these cars taped up solid. You got to sit out here until you get in the right situation when you think you can get the fastest speed.
And remember, this is a 25-minute session. And what I saw in Nationwide Series qualifying yesterday, those guys tried not to run too many laps because they didn't want to help another group run a fast
lap. Yeah, once you get comfortable, if you can, then you may want to come into the pits and set.
Look at that speed difference. Clint Bowyer, 10 miles an hour faster than the pack they just passed. And in his group is Dave Blaney in the 77, another driver that has to make this race on speed, not in a position in owner points to fall back on a provisional to make the field.
And the closing rate, like you said, Larry, is so fast that even if Jeff Gordon back here getting a nice suck on these cars in front of him, he's got to have somewhere to go when he gets there. And you can see here the confusion. Look at this.
Look, five wide coming off turn two. But right now, the way they are, they're not going to run a fast lap that way.
David Reagan in the 34, who won here a year ago, his teammate David Gilliland in the 38. Looking back at the 35, and that's Eric McClure, another driver.
Now you got to watch out. Some of these guys are coming on the pit road here too, so you got to watch that when you're coming around here trying to run a fast lap. A lot of moving parts right now going on. A lot of things happening.
Jimmy Johnson quickest right now over Trevor Bayne. Brian Vickers jumps to third. Now Harvick to second, Stewart to third, Patrick to fourth, Kurt Busch to fifth. All four Stewart Haas cars into positions 2 to 5.
They timed it out just right. They were grouped up. They got a nice pull off of a group of cars in front of them, and they got a fast speed.
Now, I've been watching Kyle Larson in this 42 car on the inside. He's been going on and off pit road. What he's been trying to do is time it where he could get with a group that was catching another group. He's been on and off pit road two or three times. Looks like he may even be coming back to pit road again. He may actually have a problem.
He's going to get run over if he didn't get out of the way.
And this time he'll stay out. Larry, he may have been on his get up to speed lap coming out of the pits and just wasn't as fast as the cars that have been out there.
He's waiting for all this big group of cars to go by, and he's going to try to catch the back of them and run a fast lap catching back up to them.
Kyle Busch, top of the chart. Remember, he'll start the race in the back due to the engine change, but he's now fastest in a Toyota. Then Joey Logano's Ford, Jimmy Johnson's Chevrolet, Michael McDowell and Brad Keselowski. Watch the 51 now. That's a rookie. Justin Allgaier trying to pull a couple of veterans around here and suck up to that front pack.
And if you notice, Kyle Busch and his teammate Matt Kenseth, the minute they ran that lap, they immediately got out of the throttle and pulled to the inside.
And Kyle Busch and Logano both just ran over 200 miles an hour.
Now, you ran that quick lap. Why do you then quickly want to get out of the way?
So you don't have someone else run a quick lap. Bring it to the pits. Let somebody else pull you around here. I'm not going to do it. That's part of the strategy.
I've been watching this group right here, led by Ryan Newman in at 31. Pretty much these are all Richard Childress Racing drivers or affiliated drivers like Casey Mears in the 13, A.J. Allmendinger in the 47.
And that's Brian Scott at the end of that pack at the 33. Wow, here comes Junior. That's Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 88.
Listen,
and
that back straightaway
has tacked onto him.
That back straightaway is like interstate traffic. I mean, cars are everywhere. I don't know how you find a lane to run in.
Joe Nemechek behind them and Terry Labonte in that silver car.
Mike, they were four wide back there going into turn three.
Will it translate to a quick lap at the line? Now, currently, Earnhardt is 24th. Here he comes with Ambrose. No change.
No change.
I just think that they were too mixed up to run a really fast lap that time.
That would be my problem. I'd be mixed up the whole session. These guys, it's amazing. They're all trying to get behind somebody to get a run up on them. And, man, it's just so confusing to do.
Maybe Carl Edwards is right. The best plan, no plan at all. React to what's in front of you.
I think that's what
behind
you. I think that's what you have to do.
Clint Bowyer on the inside in the 15. Coming toward the front, but there's nobody to break that wall of wind in front of him. Chris Devoda.
Being down here in the pits is just incredible, listening to these drivers, their crew chiefs, their spotters. You see Brad Keselowski, he is in. Normally, this is the point where he would get out of the car. He asked Paul Wolf, can I get out? Paul said, you better stay put. Brad said, where are we? He asked for a monitor so he can scan and pay attention. Right now, even being fifth isn't a safe place to be.
Yeah, fifth's a good spot because the top 24 transfer and the laps they run in this session are thrown out. they will have to re-qualify in round two, and if they make the top dozen again in round three.
See, Hamlin just ran up on the back of Alex Bowman there, had to get out of the gas, he had to abort the lap.
Landon Castle in the 40, now he and Ambrose are tied up. J.J. Yaley in the 44 just in front of them, and Castle runs out of room. He caught Yaley like he was stopped and then had nowhere to go. Fastest 24 advanced to round two. 24 live another day coming to Fox. How about car 24, Matt?
Back on pit road, intensity high on the racetrack. In fact, at one point, Jeff Gordon told his team, this is the craziest thing I've ever been involved in. And right now, they've not plugged in the cool down unit to his car. They have the Tony Stewart, but they feel like they should be safe for the next round.
Well, that's because they're 11th right now.
Yeah, one reason you don't want to run a lot of laps in this session, if you can help it, Darrell, we talked about it yesterday. The way to run fast is have the back of the car low. The more you run, you burn fuel off, and the back of the car comes up and gets that spoiler in the air that hurts the straightaway speed.
Yeah, and it's kind of a trade-off, Larry. One of the things about the tire we run here, up to a point, I mean, there's a point of everything, but up to a point, running laps on these tires makes them faster.
Now here comes Josh Wise up behind Yaley and in front of Jamie McMurray in the one. That car was crowdfunded on the internet through an internet forum, reddit.com. Their NASCAR sub forum raised over 50 grand to put Dogecoin on that car for this weekend and to get Josh Wise a fully sponsored ride for Phil Parsons Racing for Talladega. So a lot of the folks that contributed are new fans to NASCAR, and we welcome them.
With that 40 car, he just got an incredible run up the middle going down the back straightaway right there, passed everybody like they were tied to a post.
Yeah, it's Landon Castle. What I see with a lot of these drivers right here, these are drivers that are fighting just to get in the show.
Castle is 37th right now. The top 36 make the race on speed. And now Castle heads for pit road. Brian Scott down to the inside on Yaley. Greg Biffle right behind him, and then Clint Boyer. This session, though, has not been contact-free. Look
wow.
at Michael Waltrip's car.
Looks like Mikey got into something there. Oh, maybe it was. That looks like that's been into the wall right there. Yeah.
Kyle Busch.
We're showing you a shot of Michael Waltrip's car.
I can't imagine that there hadn't been some bumping and banging as tight as these guys have been running and close as they are together.
Right now, the four drivers who would miss the show, J.J. Yaley on the left of your screen in the 44. Joe Nemechek in the 87, Dave Blaney in the 77, and the 35 of Eric McClure.
I've been watching these four drivers here being pulled by Ryan Newman in that 31. We talked about them earlier. All Richard Childress drivers are affiliated with Richard Childress Racing, and they just keep trying to run that quick lap, but I just think there's not another big pack out there that's going to let them get that tow.
Yeah, you got to have somebody in front of them. I mean, we saw this with Jeff Gordon yesterday. He led a pack around here forever. They ran fast laps, but not the fastest laps.
Eleven minutes to go in round one of our three-round knockout qualifying on Fox.
Play tracks, just got to get that bad boy in the right spot.
Yeah, but right now, none of those drivers you just mentioned, Boyer or the two Truex brothers, are in the top 24 right now.
So we got about 9.5 minutes to go here. And the field has thinned dramatically.
Which
not
I think
there as many cars.
It's going to be hard for anybody to really cut a fast lap with it being this thin and with them not really assembled out there. They're just kind of all over the place right now.
Terry Labonte to the inside, that silver Ford trying to make something happen. And the 44, J.J. Yaley. He needs to get a tow to make the show. That 44 team.
Mike, but
right
I
now
really,
in danger of missing it.
I really think it's a display of restrictor plate driver talent to be able to get in a position, to get a fast lap, to understand what it takes, how to work the draft, how to work the how to get in the right spot. That's real restrictor plate savvy right there.
Ambrose trying to move up to the front of that pack. Here's Steve.
Jimmy Johnson parked on pit road. Mike, he said the car drives great. He said, I know what I'm going to do in the next session. He asked Chad Canales, hey, is this car maxed out right now? Chad didn't respond, but they have added a little bit of tape to the nose of that number 48.
And see, Steve, Kyle Busch currently P1 on the board, but the concern for Busch's team is when he got into the wall, he has cosmetic damage, not only to the rear wheel well area, but also that right front fender. NASCAR has allowed the team the okay to go ahead and change that right front. They're going to put a sticker tire on there because when he crushed that fender, it did cut into the tire.
If there's a place where putting one new tire with three older tires, that it won't really affect the handling of the car, this is probably the place.
Yeah, tires are not really much of a factor here.
No, and the rules indicate that you use the same set of tires for all three rounds of knockout qualifying unless a tire is cut. NASCAR has to approve the tire change. Now, how about the damage to Michael Waltrip, Krista?
That's what they're working on right now, checking things out. And the story with the 66, as you look over onto his car, crew chief Chad Walter down looking at things, and he just told Michael, I can't give you any guarantees. I've seen worse, but I just don't know if it's going to hold, meaning the tire and the fender damage. As the crew was pulling it, they said, all we can do is use our hands. We're not allowed to use a hammer. Michael said, well, can we at least get someone over here who's really strong?
Good point. Well, now, right now, he is 29th, Krista. He would make the race, but he would not go back out onto the track for round two. I'm sure what they're sussing out is, if other cars go faster, will he have to make another run in this session to try to make sure he holds onto that top 36 spot? Now, watch the second pack as they close on the front pack. That may be of benefit to them.
It may be, but we're talking about the tape on Jimmy Johnson's grill. You probably have race tape on for this session. You'll tape up a little bit more for the second session. Then I wouldn't be surprised you don't taper up solid or pretty close to it for the final session.
Yeah, Jamie McMurray in that one, he is sitting 33rd, and he has run 19 laps. But he or his teammate Kyle Larson in that 42, neither one of those drivers in the top 24 right now.
Joe Jr. is not in there either, Larry. He's over here in the 31st spot. Just kind of qualifying, even here in Talladega. Just hadn't worked out too good for the 88 team. They haven't got it quite figured out yet.
And you hear he's not quite wide open running in that draft, able to maintain.
They're just coming down. They're trying to group up here. They're going to go get on it here in a second.
Yeah, I think what Jamie McMurray is doing, he's kind of holding this group back with the hopes that that group will kind of get assembled in front of them and they can get that big run, but it's just not materializing right now.
Yeah, and they only got about 5.5 minutes here to get something going, and they need to get going in a hurry. The one car's 33rd. Dale Jr.'s 31st. Biffle's back there. He's 36.
Yeah, Truex way back, and so is David Reagan.
It's almost like no driver out there right now is really up to speed. It's like they're kind of doing a waiting game.
5:20 to go, boys. Running out of time.
A lot of cat and mouse being played here. Nobody wants to be in front of the pack that wins the pole. Everybody wants a shot to close up on the way to the finish line and get that best lap.
Well, right in front of McMurray here is this group of cars, and they're waiting. And McMurray's waiting for the group in front of him to get going.
David Reagan's not waiting. Here
looks
he
like,
goes.
Looks like they're going to take off, and then McMurray will try to time it to where they catch these guys.
And Earnhardt's coming to the garage, coming to the pits, that is.
I think Dale Jr. said, hey, this ain't working. Ain't nobody going anywhere. I quit. Got 4.5 minutes to go. They're going to have to get something going if they're going to make a move here.
Just for a second there, it looked like David Gilliland was pushing his teammate Eric McClure in the 35 and actually got Eric a little bit loose going down to the trial.
Yeah, McClure went to the apron. Now, every car that is on the track at this moment is outside the top 24 that would advance. So the fight that's going on right here is to make the race.
Just don't think there's enough cars out there now to make that happen. And we're running out of time. We got 4 minutes to go.
Yeah, I just think everything is against these guys for running that fast lap. I think the number of laps they've run, you see the speed difference right there between David Reagan in the 34 and McMurray in that one back there, and just not enough drivers out there right now.
There is a chance that the McMurray and this group, McMurray the 11 and the 42,
if they timed it right, there's a chance they could pick up some speed off of that David Reagan group in front of them, but it's pretty slim.
36th is still Greg Biffle. That's the last position to be decided on time, and you see a 3 mile per hour spread, two now, between the front pack and that second pack trying to catch them and improve their position.
Darrell, the thing I question, do they have enough drivers in their group? I'm just not sure three is enough trying to catch those three or four up there.
No, we'll find out, because they're definitely there's a nice pack in front of them, in front of it, McMurray and these guys. If there's a chance, it's now.
Because we're down to 3 minutes, which is only about 3 to 4 laps.
And no change in the top 36 as they came by the start-finish line. Krista.
Brad Keselowski is out of his car, and you have said that knockout qualifying works for us because we know how to maneuver the variables. Can you do that here at Talladega?
Well, we're into the second round. We're going to make it to the second round, it looks like. Really interesting, you know. I'll give NASCAR credit. This actually worked out better than I thought it was going to be, and I think it's a lot of fun to watch. It's kind of interesting right now watching the guys battling to just make the show still out there on the track. You know, without enough cars out there, you can't put up a fast lap, but you can definitely fight to make the show. So I think that's fun to watch. But just ready to get to the next round. Our teammate Joey Logano and I worked really well together, and hopefully we can get into the third round and then a shot at the pole.
All right, and until he goes back out there, he's going to do what you guys are doing at home. He's going to watch it.
Let's see what McMurray does here. This could be his best chance.
And Darrell, he holds in 33rd.
Yep. Well, that was the best chance of anybody that anybody had, with those guys sucking up on the group that was in front of them. Not a very big group either.
2 minutes to go. Time for two more laps on the board.
You know, back to Brad Keselowski, of course, this is totally different from anything else, but we have had 7 rounds of knockout qualifying. Brad Keselowski and that two, they've been on the front row 6 out of 7 times this year.
Well, front row J-Lo there, he's looking pretty good, too. He's second right now, but that doesn't mean he's going to be on there when they get down to the end.
That's Joey Logano, Keselowski's teammate in the 22. Now, Marcus Ambrose is back out there. He is 27th, leading Greg Biffle along, who is 36th.
If nothing else, this has given Marcus Ambrose in that 9 a lot of track time with what's a backup car after that practice crash yesterday.
And again, no change, as Darrell and Brad Keselowski have both said. Not a big enough hole being punched in the wind by a pack of cars out front for the second group to gain appreciably.
No, you can put up a good time now, but you're not going to put up a great time. There's just not enough cars.
We're in the final minute of round one of this 3-round knockout qualifying.
And it's really going to become more and more interesting as we go into the next session. Remember, I only have 24 cars now. So it really is going to come down to teammates in this next go-round.
Yeah, 24 cars in only 10 minutes.
10 minutes. And you got to hope that when you get to the final 12, you hope all your buddies are in there with you.
And all of these times get set aside, and you'll have to re-qualify to make the final round of 12.
And with only 18 seconds left, this will be the last lap, because the red and the black will come out. They'll be able to complete this lap.
Every driver on track at the moment has run at least 20 laps in this 25-lap session. Now, Joe Nemechek, Eric McClure, J.J. Yaley, and Dave Blaney right now are the cars that would go home based on their speeds. So this will be the final lap. Time has expired. Next time past the start-finish line is the last time. There's McClure.
I think they're all going to come in, Mike. Yeah,
they're coming
in.
They've
just realized it's not going to happen now.
But look at Logano and McDowell and Joey Logano and McDowell and Keselowski. They went out together. Remember, they were the first cars on the track. They put up the fast lap, and they stayed there.
So here are the cars. Top 36 make the race, and then 7 provisional positions based on car owner points and champions provisional. That means that Joe Nemechek will not make the race in the 87. J.J. Yaley there in the 44. This is Dave Blaney. There's Yaley, who goes home today, and so does the Virginia driver, Eric McClure. Round one is over. Jimmy Johnson, third in a Chevrolet. Joey Logano, second in a Ford. Kyle Busch's Toyota, fastest. 24, live another day. 2-hour premiere Monday on Fox. rookie for Sutherland is Jack Bauer. Car 24 is among the 24 cars moving on to round number two. And here is how they finished round one. The Penske teammates right up there together, Logano and Keselowski. And look at that foursome. That's Stuart Haas Racing, who ran together and all qualified right together.
See Trevor Bayne there in a 21 car driving a limited schedule for the Wood Brothers. He was quick in practice yesterday.
I think it's interesting, the guys. Look at Brian Scott in the 33. He's up there. You drop down there a little bit further, and Reed Sorensen in the 36 car. He made the top 24. These are guys that we probably wouldn't see in the top 24 if it was single car qualifying.
Hey, you got the teammates of Mike Lynette and Reed Sorensen.
Yeah.
All right, let's go out back down to pit road and Matt.
Kyle Larson turned in the 30th fastest time. New format for Sprint Cup. What was the biggest challenge with these cars on this track?
Just for us, I don't know. We got out there in a group, but I guess the officials made us come down pit road for something, and lost our group and kind of lost our plan there. So just had to form up on whatever was out there and just couldn't get the right or get tagged onto the right group to go fast enough. So sucks we qualified back there, but it doesn't really matter a whole lot, I don't think. Our target Chevy was fast in practice yesterday, so should be a good race tomorrow.
Thank you, Kyle. Mike?
Thanks, Matt. 24 move on. Here are the drivers who've earned positions 25 through 43 in the lineup for Sunday's race. Rookie Ryan Truex there. Last year's Rookie of the Year, Ricky Stenhouse. That's where Marcus Ambrose, Waltrip, Boyer, and Kyle Larson round at the top 30. How about Dale Jr., 31st?
Yeah, Dale Earnhardt Jr. won the last restrictor plate race at Daytona, the Daytona 500. Jamie McMurray in that one won the last time we were here back last fall.
Yep, Denny Hamlin back there, Greg Biffle.
Greg Biffle 36th with a 48.54.
Front row center Martin Truex from Daytona, 38th.
Yep, Josh Wise, Terry Labonte, rookie Allgaier with Landon Castle, David Reagan, David Gilliland. It'll all be in the Aaron's 499 come Sunday. And we'll move on to round two next. Saturday night, May 17th, winner take all for $1 million. It's the NASCAR Sprint Cup All-Star Race from Charlotte Motor Speedway, part of Fox Sports 1's 10 Days of Thunder, 8:30 Eastern on Fox Sports 1. To find your channel, go to foxsports1.com today. 24 drivers move on, and here's Matt Yocum.
And one driver not moving on is Dale Earnhardt Jr., 31st fastest time. A lot of guys had game plans, and then they couldn't execute the game plans. Is that what happened to your team, Junior?
No, I don't think anybody had a plan. I mean, just go out there and run, and however you finish, really. I don't know what we could have done different. You just go out there and run, and in the draft, it's hard to put up the fastest lap. We're not too worried about it. We'll be able to pick a pretty decent stall, and that's about all. I mean, ain't much else to it. It's pretty boring, but I don't know if that's the answer at these places. We could probably run some heat races or something. It'd be funner than that.
All right, thank you, Junior.
Picking his stall means picking his pit position for Sunday, and he will pick 31st. That's where he qualified. Kyle Busch's strategy for this round.
Tony, is there an update on the plan, or is it still, I guess, say good as new, but I will say not too bad. I never get to have this much fun. I think the plan's pretty much waived. There's only three of us that made it, the 18, 20, and 55, right? Yeah, that'd probably be the three that stuck to the plan. Best case scenario would be just for us three to get in line and then figure it out from there. At least try to stick together that way, figure the.
Now he's talking about lining up with Matt Kenseth and Brian Vickers, the other Toyotas in this group. Once again, Team Penske out first. Brad Keselowski in white, Joey Logano in yellow. They're trailed by Casey Kane, Eric Almirola, and the 95 again, Michael McDowell.
I think what I heard was if you stuck to the plan, you were all right. But some guys aborted the plan and went off on their own, and it didn't work out so good. So right now we've got three very distinct packs, and it's each one of these groups that think they know what the hot tip is.
And they all are lined up in a single file right now because I think they know that's the way we'll cut that fast lap.
And then there's the Lone Ranger, Jimmy Johnson. He usually practices all by himself. He's out on track all by himself, but if he can run down that front pack, that could be a big lap.
Yeah, Mr. Lonely is looking for a friend right now, and he may find one ahead of him here.
Need to watch this pack right there. It's led by Ryan Newman in the 31. Once again, all of the Richard Childress Racing drivers and their affiliates, including Michael Annette in the 7, gets his engines from Earnhardt Childress Racing.
Here comes my guys right here, the 41, the 10. Carl Edwards in the middle of them again, the 24. That's the guys I think will lay down the fast lap. Guys and gals that will lay down the fast lap. Danica right up in there with them.
Now that's the four Stewart Haas cars, plus Edwards in a Ford and Jeff Gordon's Hendrick Chevrolet. Steve?
Talking strategy, and Danica Patrick, Mike, she just said, I think if we get in a long straight line instead of a bunch of little groups, we'll be fast. She also added the car feels different in the way it handles compared to Daytona.
Casey Kane, top of the chart now.
Wonder if it's different in a good way or in a bad way.
Brian Newman goes to the top with his teammate, Austin Dillon.
With all of his teammates, all of them, they're 1 through 7 in that group right now.
Hold the phone, boys.
Not fast enough. 6, Tony Stewart.
Didn't quite get
the fastest in that pack. Casey Mears is up for 5th. Allmendinger 3rd, but it's the 31 of Ryan Newman, the Rocket, heading up this session.
Yeah, Newman's got his little group up here, 5 of them, and then back here behind him is the 41 and that group of 6. So right now it looks like that the Newman group has got the best setup.
This round, 10 minutes long, it'll set positions 13 to 24 and 12 move on. Keselowski top of the chart. Brian Scott takes over the top spot.
I like that second group because I think they're close enough to that front 5 that's up there led by Brad Keselowski that they're really getting the benefit of that group.
You know what? They do too, Larry. And so you know what? They said, let's quit.
Yes, just because you know what?
Richard
Childress Racing got bit yesterday in Nationwide Series qualifying by staying out there, and they helped the Joe Gibbs drivers.
Got top 6, all Richard Childress Racing affiliates, including this 33 for Brian Scott, moving up to run a few cup races from out of the Nationwide Series. You're looking ahead to Tony Stewart from his teammate, Kevin Harvick. They are currently 7th and 6th.
Boys, it's going to be pretty hard to put down a fast lap now because the car, summer cars are slowing down, waiting to regroup here, and we've only got 6 minutes to go.
They're doing that for a reason, because what they're doing, they're going to hurt this group led by Kurt Busch in the 41 by being up there running that slow. There was a method to their madness, slowing down on the racetrack.
Yeah, but they didn't want them to get the pull. They didn't want to get the draft, so they slowed down so they couldn't catch to the back of them. Now the roles are reversed.
Oh, and Mr. Lonely all there by himself. He is 21st of 24, that being the 48 of Jimmy Johnson.
It's just not a, you know, as I watch this group here, the 41 of Kurt Busch, Danica, that group, they're just not tight enough.
And the 3 Toyotas stay lined up together, but they're cruising at pace car speed, waiting for a tow, maybe from this group.
They're waiting for that group, exactly what they're doing. Now, we're almost halfway through this second round, only 5 minutes to go.
Yeah, this group just can't, they're not quite tight enough. They're not close enough to each other.
Now, Carl Edwards, that's in that group in that 99, he just jumped up there to 3rd.
Yeah, but he fell back a little bit, Larry, and he got him a run.
Danica Patrick right now on the bubble to advance. She is 12th. 12 cars go to round 3. Steve, what's Jimmy Johnson doing?
Well, here's what his feedback was, Mike. He said, that was not good. I'm going to try and fall back and try again. Chad Canal said, I don't know where you will fall back to. We've lost our window.
Well, look at the closing speed with Trevor Bayne in that 21 with Keselowski in the 2.
Yeah, 18 miles an hour faster than Jimmy Johnson. Just overhauls him. Now, if Johnson can stay with that pack and they come around and run another lap, that may work in Jimmy's favor. Lower right of the screen, you see Danica Patrick is 12th. Trevor Bayne not going to make any advance on that.
Jimmy might be in a good spot here.
Yep.
He's got Amarola behind him, and he's got a group in front of him, but the group in front of him says, you're not going to pull out, you're not going to get a draft off of us. Sorry.
And that may have been it for Jimmy's chance to advance.
Well, we got about 3.5 minutes to go here, and I think the games have been played.
Darrell, whoever thought you'd use the brakes during qualifying at Talladega?
But I think all of these drivers watched that Nationwide Series qualifying yesterday, and they were fast, quick learners because drivers running too many laps, it ended up biting them.
The same guy that would have thought Brian Scott would be the fastest of the 24 cars that just went out on the track.
Well,
look at our top five.
Yeah. Brian Scott was fastest of that group because he was the fifth car in line. He could drag back at the start-finish line, and as they came back around, he could close up to the car in front of him, and that gave him the fastest lap. Now, with 3 minutes to go, the caution flag waves for debris in turn number one. That will stop the clock until we go green once again.
I just love our top five. It's amazing. Scott Allmendinger, Carl Edwards in there, Mears, and our post hitter from Daytona in a three car, Austin Dillon. What an interesting top five.
And right now, the top 12 that would advance include this Ford and 11 Chevrolets. Now, even though the red flag was waved at start finish, which would stop the clock, they have now changed this to a yellow flag, and that means that the clock continues to run.
It's just going to be really hard, I think, for these drivers to get back out there and assemble a group quick enough, I think, to overtake that bunch that's up there in the top half dozen or so.
Yeah, I agree, Larry.
Well, how do you feel about Danica Patrick's 12th place spot if these cars can gather up and get one more run? Is she safe to advance?
I think she is. I think that the top 12 are the top 12. I don't see anybody knocking anybody out now.
And she's started on the front row at Daytona in the 500.
Well, as long as it takes to get up to speed here, they're going to have to be leaving pit road within about the next minute to be able to get up to speed and start a lap. And I just don't see them running a fast lap by just running one lap.
Now, the track is yellow, which means you can be on the track, but at pace car speed, not at race speed. Yeah. Trying to wind up for that final lap. Looks like it's not going to happen. And the Team Penske strategy is going to fall just short. There's Brad Keselowski. He is 13th. His teammate Joey Logano is 17th. Looks like they will not advance to round three.
There's some cars sitting here on the end of pit road. Some pretty good race cars that may be able to get a lap in. It's going to be hard, though. We're down to a minute and 10 seconds.
Can't do it, Darrell.
They're going to have to get rolling here, and they're not going to make it.
Because once the session ends and the red and black flags are shown, you get one chance to come by the start-finish line, which means they would have to be up to speed now in order to start a final lap.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to happen. I mean, essentially, this session is over, even though we have 52 seconds. Yeah, all they're going to do here is put another lap on their tires, and that's about it.
I wonder if some of these drivers might have thought the clock stopped for that debris.
That's what I'm thinking, that they think because the yellow's out, the clock stopped.
And we did see the red flag initially, which would indicate that. So here's Krista.
Yeah, Mike, I've been listening to driver Brad Keselowski, crew chief Paul Wolf. You are correct. They thought the clock was stopped. They had misunderstood. They thought the clock had stopped, so they came in to put tape on the grill and send Brad back out to try to get that fast lap. As Brad rolled out, they said, "We don't have time." The clock did not stop.
Well, you see, 8 seconds. They're not even going to make it back around to take the green.
I kind of felt like those guys sitting on the end of pit road thought the clock had stopped and the session had been extended, but apparently not. Time is out.
Time is over. They didn't stop the clock.
So time has expired, and the confusion is understandable because the red flag, which stops the clock, was the first flag displayed for debris. And then NASCAR recalled the red flag and issued the yellow. Danica Patrick will advance to round three. And we listened in on Jimmy Johnson, who winds up 21st.
You got to get behind that roof. I meant the 22 because he was last. You know, Chad, there's only so many options. Give me a chance here. Trying to make Earl understand what your objective needs to be.
On board, I get it.
I wasn't telling you to get behind the 22. I was trying to make sure Earl understand that you need to get to the back of that pack, Jimmy.
I get that, but I'm driving, and I didn't go back there. So we both get you. I was just trying to, I thought maybe avoid being the last car in line and trying to have a car or two behind me was going to be a better play.
Talking about Earl, that's Earl Barbin, the spotter up on the roof, who communicates to Jimmy where other cars are around the racetrack because his crew chief, Chad Knaus, can't see much past either end of pit road.
Frustrating, huh?
It can be. 12 of our 24 drivers will advance to round three. The remainder earn positions 13 through 24 in the starting lineup for the Aaron's 499. They include two Chevys, three Toyotas, and the rest Fords.
It's six against four now. There are six Childress-related cars in the top 12, and there are four Stewart Haas cars in the top 12.
Note that Kyle Busch in 20th, he'll have to start in the back due to the engine change. Jimmy Johnson, Matt Kenseth, the two winningest drivers from last year, do not advance. Former 500 winner Trevor Bain. But Danica Patrick, 12th by 3/10 of a second. She will advance into the final round. Penske teammates talk it over. And let's show you the drivers who will advance.
Yeah, I was looking at that. Six against four. It was Jeff Gordon and Carl Edwards, the two odd men out.
Carl Edwards, the real odd man out. He's the only Ford driver in the top 12.
Who will win the pole? Stick around. Here at Talladega, two of three rounds of knockout qualifying for the Aaron's 499 are in the books.
Here we go.
Kevin Harvick and his Stewart Haas teammates.
Hey, they're hustling this time, buddy. They want to get going here.
Well, you only have 5 minutes.
You got to get on it. Look at Carl. I love Carl Edwards. You remember yesterday in practice, he was determined to get in the middle of that Hendrick group, and today he's determined to stick with that Stewart Haas group.
He is locked onto the back of Kurt Busch's bumper like a dog after a mailman.
Yeah, remember yesterday, Tony Stewart tried to block him, and he wouldn't let him do it.
I'm not really surprised at what I'm seeing right here, because a lot of crew chiefs told me in the garage area that we were going to wait a little bit. We didn't want to go out there and run four or five laps, because to our point earlier, you don't want to help another group of drivers run a fast lap.
Well, they better, you know, they didn't do very good the management of the clock in the last session. They better manage the clock here a little bit.
Based on what they told me, I would not be surprised to see the thing get down to close to 3 minutes before they actually leave pit road.
This looks like grammar school. Nobody wants to sit in the front row. Krista.
Well, I talked to Brad a few moments ago in the first session. You talked about having fun. That second session, I know there was some confusion on whether the clock had stopped. If it hadn't, would you guys, been able to have time to get back out there and make another run?
Well, you never know. I didn't know there was a rule that the clock didn't stop. I thought anytime there was a stop on the action or you had to come off the track, the clock stopped. Obviously that wasn't the case, and you don't know. I mean, maybe we'd have gone out there and never gone any faster. We sure would like to have that opportunity, so I'll have to get an explanation on that one. But either way, the Miller Lite Ford was really fast, and we just missed it by a little bit. It's hard to tell. All the packs are so close, and we just needed a tiny bit more.
Thanks, Brad.
Now remember, when the clock gets to zero, you can only come by the start-finish line once and have your time recorded.
I think they're going to wait again to roughly 3 minutes, because what is 3 minutes? It's a get-up-to-speed lap and then basically two laps.
Well, you don't want to help the other guys. So if you can get a fast lap, you don't want to help somebody else get a fast lap.
Steve.
Well, somebody's going to have to go.
Yes.
It will not be Danica Patrick. She just said we do not want to be the first car in line because all the cars behind us will be faster. Let's be at the end like we planned.
Well, we've seen that in the first two sessions, that you do not want to be the lead driver, but we're getting close to halfway through this session.
You're only going to get one lap now.
Yeah,
because
you
get up to speed lap, and then one lap, and then you're out of time.
Okay, so if that's the case, you can improve.
Exactly.
So you're playing the odds here. You're going to put down the fast lap, and you're not going to help anybody else get a better lap.
Wonder how they'll line up the field if nobody goes.
Well, just like it is.
But fastest in round three wins the pole.
Boys and girls, time to go. Here we go.
Tempest Fugit.
Here we go. Now the mad rush.
I just think those Childress drivers, they're going to stick together, and I think they're going to be in a good position, led by Ryan Newman in that 31.
Oh, I totally agree.
Carl Edwards in the 99 has no friends. He is the only Ford among the 12 cars out here. He is going to have to catch that duo in front. That's Kurt Busch and Jeff Gordon. I don't think they have time to come around twice.
No, they're going to come by. They're going to have just about enough time to make a lap. That's it.
And I think that's all they wanted to do. Again, Richard Childress Racing got burnt yesterday in Nationwide Series qualifying by running too many laps in the final session.
So they learned from what happened yesterday. These guys all watched. I watched all the crew chiefs, drivers, all the cup guys were watching qualifying yesterday.
I think the place to be is at the tail end of this big pack. Those two cars trailing, Danica Patrick and the car behind her, are in the best chance to run a catch-up lap second time by.
Let's see them. They're just kind of playing with the throttle right now, trying to get themselves in the right spot.
1 minute six to go. You might have time to make it around and run another lap.
I think they'll get two laps in.
But that pack just slowed down, Larry. They slowed down. I'm not sure what the game are playing, but they slowed down a little bit going by.
Tony Stewart has the quickest lap, but that was not a lap at full speed. 59 seconds. They will make it back and have a chance to run a final lap. Everything's on until the flag starts waving. Then you get one more chance to cross the start finish.
I like this little group right here because they're the ones that have really had the momentum and got a pretty fast lap. But there are some cars at the back of this big pack that may be able to suck up here at the end and put a fast lap down. Let's see what happens. Here they come.
Jeff Gordon leads them through the tri-oval. Kurt Busch, Carl Edwards, Tony Stewart hanging back. Edwards to the top, Stewart to the top. Stewart. And he's in the best position if he can close.
But those eight drivers back there at the back, they're in a single file, but they're actually starting to get spread out just a little bit, led by Ryan Newman in the 31.
And the clock just struck zero, so we're finished this lap.
You got Stewart Danica by Patrick. Himself. He is not gaining on that front pack now.
But watch Paul Menard in the 27 because he's tucked up the closest in the middle of this pack to those four drivers in front of him.
Ryan Newman in the 31 car there, he's got it. No, that car ahead of him just went up the hill.
All right, Stewart's done. Brian Scott in the 33 closing once again.
He got a great suck up that time to Paul Menard in the 27.
This is it. This is for the pole. Here they come to the line. Kurt Busch, Austin Dillon, Brian Scott. That Scott does it.
That run he got through 3 and 4, Mike.
Good job, Brian Scott, buddy. Gonna be on the pole right here.
Hey.
Oh, yeah, baby.
How about
good
that?
Work, boys.
And look at the cars that are at the top five. Look where they all come from.
Richard Childress Racing.
Top six.
And their affiliated teams.
But, Mike, to your point earlier, Paul Menard in the 27 and Brian Scott in the 33, they were fourth and fifth in line, and they're first and second.
Pretty interesting. Not very funny, but very interesting.
How about that? And Carl Edwards had no friends, 10th of 12 for the only Ford in the top dozen. Boise, Idaho's Brian Scott has won his first career Sprint Cup pole in only his fifth start. His teammate Paul Menard at RCR, Richard Childress Racing, will share the front row. As Larry pointed out, there is Scott trailing that pack and in best position to close up on the lead group. As much as 2 miles an hour faster than Ryan Newman, who leads that group as they came to the line on the final lap, and he will be the ninth different pole winner of 2014. Krista.
And all of his RCR teammates have come over to congratulate Brian Scott. You said, I was the guy yesterday. Today, it's your day. Talk about the strategy.
Yeah, it was a team effort. Big thanks to Joe Falk, Circle Sport Racing. Everybody at RCR, ECR Engines, it's always a team effort to get these super speedway poles. And we had a plan from the beginning to work as a team, about seven of us in a line. With Newman leading it, he was the point man, and I know how that feels because I was the point man in the Nationwide car yesterday. You feel like you don't really have a shot, but you do it to be a team player. And like I said, it's awesome for everybody at Richard Childress Racing, Shore Lodge, Chevrolet. The Chevy SS was really fast, and we were able to get the right draft and the right suck there right at the last second. To get the pole, and couldn't be more happy for everybody.
Congratulations, Brian Scott, your pole sitter. Mike?
Scott started 12th at Daytona in February, as Paul Menard and Ryan Newman talk it over. Brian Scott, sixth different driver, get his first Sprint Cup pole at Talladega. Brian Scott joins Austin Dillon as first-time pole winners in 2014.
Six Richard Childress-affiliated cars in the top six. And then you go down, and the five cars of the Hendrick-affiliated group are in the other five.
And Brian Scott will be in the 2015 Sprint Unlimited race as well.
Nice run from Michael McDowell, who had to race his way into the field. Didn't have a provisional start spot available. A lot of contenders here. Way back at row 11, Jimmy Johnson, Matt Kenseth.
Yeah, Michael Aneto, that's a great run for him in the 7. And you got Reed Sorensen down there, and there's Trevor Bayne. I mean, some guys that are up deep in the field right now. There's Ryan Truex.
Another good mix of rookies and veterans with Ambrose Waltrip and Earnhardt Jr.
Cole Witt up there. There's Alex Bowman.
Mike, you know the only thing I regret about this knockout qualifying? That we just started it in 2014.
Yeah. I regret it's over. I want to do it again.
But tomorrow they'll run 499 miles on Talladega. NASCAR on Fox coverage begins at 11:30 a.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1. And here on Fox at 12:30 Eastern Time, the Aaron's 499. Tonight, The Simpsons on a special Saturday night leads off primetime on Fox. We'll see you tomorrow right here for the Aaron's 499.